In the vast reaches of space, there exists an alien entity that threatens the survival of all civilizations. It is Velber, the Umbral Star, and it travels the cosmos in search of sentient life to destroy and consume. Upon detecting a planet with signs of life, the Umbral Star creates an entity called an anti-cell, which it sends to the surface to ravage and devour its inhabitants. In general, Velber circumvents the universe in trips lasting 14,000 years, passing through the Milky Way galaxy once per interval. This is detrimental, of course, as Earth in the Paleolithic era is home to human life, presided over by a massive supercomputer called the Moon Cell, thought to be built by the same alien race that designed Velber. As the Umbral Star passes through Earth's orbit, it releases subvessels, pieces of its outer armor called Arcs of the Stars. Of the three it dispatches, the most deadly by far contains the anti-cell Velber 02, Sephar, which plunges herself into the Moon Cell, plundering the vast majority of its recorded data. From there, she summons herself on the Earth's surface as a gigantic white titan, where she proceeds to annihilate nearly all of the planet's life. At the same time, however, the Moon Cell analyzes Velber's structure and defends itself. Utilizing the Moon Cell's automaton, it summons heroes from Earth's past, present, and future to counteract Sephar's rampage. Even gods, born from the wishes of mankind, take to the task of fighting this foe. Among them, Mars, the Roman god of war, is defeated by the Titan, allowing her to claim his divine blade, the Photon Ray. With this acquisition, it appears that the Earth is doomed. However, one other divine construct, the Holy Sword Excalibur, is wielded to ultimately vanquish Sephar's Titan body. The Moon Cell itself is able to quarantine her Ark of the Stars, sealing it away in part of Seraph labeled the Zero Dark. Defeated, yet still alive, Sephar sleeps within her Velber shard, waiting for the Umbral Star to return after another 14,000 years. In anticipation, the Moon Cell develops a protocol to jam the star's sensors, essentially hiding itself and the Earth from further attacks. For the assault, Velber designed Sephar from the data of a previously consumed civilization, sealing away her sense of self to serve as a weapon. But now, in quarantine, she is able to contemplate her purpose. As she sleeps, she dreams of her residual corpse left on Earth in the aftermath of her battle, a mortal form reborn as a human child. The people on Earth eventually enshrine both her resting body along with the Sword of Mars, where she is abandoned for many years. At the dawn of the 5th century, her ruins are discovered by a group of Eurasian nomads, descendants of the Zhonggu people, called the Huns. They come upon the child, witnessing war tattoos inscribed upon her flesh. After waking the girl, the Hun elders are shocked to see her defend herself against an armed man. Essentially, with no father, mother, or any memories to speak of, she is deemed as a child of combat and raised by the Hun as an embodiment of destruction named Attila. Over the following 50 years, the Huns migrate deeper into Western territory, building an empire from the remnants of conquered lands. Attila takes the throne for herself, becoming leader of the Huns, leading many campaigns into Rome, subjugating surrounding areas by forcing them to pay tribute or suffer the Huns' military might. On horseback, her armies conquer a broad territory, spanning from Western Asia, Russia, Eastern Europe, and Gaul. As part of her campaign and Hun tradition, she takes on various wives. After the death of her current wife, she marries Kriemhild, the former wife of the German hero Siegfried. Despite their matrimony, Kriemhild is mainly entering into this relationship to take advantage of Attila's forces, to seek aid in avenging Siegfried's death at the hands of Hagen and her own brother Gunther. Ultimately, this becomes only a small part of Attila's vast conquest. Attila fights like a raging tempest, barely acknowledging that she has allies following behind her. Instead, she charges forward, fixated on domination. Beyond that, however, in the deep recesses of her consciousness, Attila harbors a more basic wish. She desires to leave behind proof of her existence, to bring prosperity to her clan. Thus, even the Great Conqueror herself has a distinctly human element that transcends her destructive nature. Through her campaign, she amasses lands so vast she cannot control them all. This conquest, while rapid and voluminous, is short-lived. In the year 453, she feasts in celebration of her latest marriage and begins profusely bleeding after drinking heavily. Her esophageal veins dilate and burst, causing her to hemorrhage and bleed out from her nose and mouth. Despite this, as she lay dying in a pool of her own blood, her thoughts remain fixated on felling Rome. In her absence, the Huns' empire rapidly dissolves, but is credited as a contributing factor to the collapse of the Roman Empire. Despite this abrupt end, the name Attila goes down in history as one of the world's most ferocious conquerors. She becomes feared by all of Europe as the Scourge of God, and in some timelines, her legend is recorded into the Throne of Heroes. On Earth, the Frankish king, Charlemagne, also comes across the ruins dedicated to Sephar. Upon touching the ruin's massive mural, he has a vision of Earth's destruction. Choosing life, this inspires Charlemagne to pacify Europe. In the universe of the Moon Cell, Attila's life is experienced by the Titan in the form of a dream throughout her long slumber. Through her dreams as Attila, the Titan develops a sparkling glimmer of humanity, prompting her to question her predetermined mission as Velber's Scion of Destruction. Thus, she awakens to a new persona, Altera. Here, she is introverted yet determined, a combination of three separate personalities: her sensitive sweet side, her warrior's instinct, and her merciful kindness. While Altera longs to re-experience the sensation of racing onward through the rolling plains as Attila, she admits this is but a fanciful dream. Regardless, her massive size makes her appear intimidating, terrifying even. Her modest gaze leads others to fear her, preventing any form of intimate connection. Thus, despite yearning to communicate, Altera simply accepts the fear and acts accordingly. During her 14,000-year-old slumber, the Moon Cell is changed. It fosters the Spiritron embodiment of various humans and artificial intelligences alike, granting them a home in its serial phantasm, Seraph. Resulting from a deadly array of Holy Grail wars, a single master, Hakuno Kishinami, prevails and is granted authority of the Moon Cell in the form of a ring, the Regalia. While it appears that Seraph has found relative peace, that tranquility is short-lived, as its technician, Archimedes, discovers the Zero Dark and learns about the Umbral Star. While he was once a human, Archimedes counts himself as a mathematician, a rational thinker, over anything else. He wickedly deems the Umbral Star to be a superior entity, and takes it upon himself to assist Velber's plan of consuming all life on Earth and in the Moon Cell. Using the temptation of protecting their beloved servants, Archimedes convinces Hakuno to venture with him into the Zero Dark, to use the Regalia to destroy whatever lies within. There, they find the Titan Altera resting atop a mound of treasure. Archimedes uses Hakuno to destroy the Titan, but Hakuno senses something awry. Regardless, Altera takes their invasion as hostile and grasps Hakuno in a tight fist. Seeing this, Archimedes reveals his true colors, admitting to have set this up as a trap to kill Hakuno as a vassal of the Umbral Star, commanding Altera to crush them. In an act of self-defense, Hakuno splits both himself and the Regalia into three separate pieces. When chastised by Archimedes, Altera violently chases him off, deciding that Hakuno, alive or dead, bears no relevance on her plan to destroy the Moon Cell. In fact, now that the Regalia has been split, Altera intends to use her third of the Master, Hakuno's body, as a means of escaping her confinement in conquering the Moon Cell as a servant. While it's natural for Hakuno to try and escape imprisonment, Altera notices that Hakuno is missing memories. With such a clean slate, Altera is a bit disappointed by Hakuno's opposition, but then again, she is keeping them isolated to a cave, forced to sleep inside a cage. Furthermore, Altera, declaring herself to be the enemy of humanity, doesn't exactly come off as friendly. In order to leave the Zero Dark and fight within Seraph, Altera creates an avatar of herself that, because it drains her resources, shrinks to the size of a normal human. This pseudo-servant, Hero Altera, can only manifest with the help of a master, and so Altera toys with the typical master-servant partnership to ensure Hakuno supplies her with mana, but cannot interfere with her conquest. In exchange for their assistance, Altera offers Hakuno freedom from the cage to barter for cooperation. In battle, Altera's hero avatar wears the regalia and keeps Hakuno trapped within it. When taking on other servants in battle programs throughout Seraph, she fights using the Sword of Mars, Photon Ray. This sword, the prototype of all divine constructs, has a blade made from tri-colored bands of light. When swung, it streaks the light of a rainbow, with the power to destroy any and all existence. When Altera calls its true name, Teardrop Photon Ray, Star of Tears, the blade itself serves merely as a beacon with which to summon Mars's wrath. Mars loathes Altera, and upon establishing a connection with the sword, launches a photon ray from the heavens to smite her. With the sword and her own mana, Altera is able to redirect this stream of light to decimate her opponents. While fighting, Altera feels reminiscent of her time as Attila, causing her to wonder just how long this dream of hers will last. On separate occasions, Altera's Zero Dark is invaded by top servants of the Moon Cell, acting on the computer's behalf to vanquish her. She defeats the first invader, Iskandar, King of Conquerors, who submits to her will as the superior warrior. As thanks for offering mana, Altera provides food and allows Hakuno to roam the cavern between battles. During this time, Altera yearns to touch Hakuno, but is worried about being feared. Hakuno, on the other hand, is quite curious about Altera's titan body, climbing about her playfully. Tired, Hakuno rests upon Altera's stomach, and the titan finds joy in their gentle physical contact. Through Hakuno, Altera is able to explore her human emotions, further helping her question her role as a destroyer. While her hero form is blunt and aggressive, she too develops an intimate bond with Hakuno during their fights. Jeanne d'Arc is the next to invade Altera's domain, and during their bout, Gilgamesh interrupts, hoping for a chance to battle Sephar directly. He launches a poisoned weapon at Altera, nearly costing her the fight. Thus far, Altera had only been using Hakuno's mana, never once asking for help. However, Hakuno decides to be the first to actively help, using a code cast to clear Altera's poison. Their fight comes to a close, when Gilgamesh admits that Sephar once spared his own father during her destruction. To repay that debt, Gilgamesh joins her ranks while refusing to take orders. Again, between battles, Hakuno and Altera grow closer. Hakuno's cage is replaced with more suitable lodgings. Their cave becomes a special place to them. Amidst this, Hakuno declares to be fighting to free Altera from her destiny as a weapon, despite constantly being told such a thing is impossible. Altera, now with the help of Iskandar, Jeanne, and Gilgamesh, decides to take the offensive in her conquest of Seraph. She wages war against Nero and Tamamo, who happen to possess the other pieces of the regalia, as well as the other parts of Hakuno's cyberframe. Of all the cyberframe's components, the body is most vulnerable, destined to fade away if not reunited with its mind and soul. Altera wants to restore Hakuno's cyberframe, but is interrogated by Elizabeth Bathory, Archimedes' co-conspirator with Velber, as to where her allegiance lies. Their plan is to complete the regalia and use it to shut down the Moon Cell's jamming device, allowing Velber to effectively return. Elizabeth fears Altera's affections for Hakuno might lead her astray. Despite believing herself to be nothing but a destroyer, she finds hope in Hakuno's determination. She admits she does not want to become Sephar ever again, instead sharing a similar goal to her dream as Attila. Upon defeating Tamamo and acquiring Hakuno's soul, Altera has conquered over half of Seraph. With Nero being their next target, Elizabeth points out that if Altera happens to save Hakuno by acquiring their mind, the completion of their cyberframe will wipe out the memories they shared up until now. Driven to despair, Altera continues her assault. After infiltrating Nero's realm and defeating Gawain, Altera discovers that Nero had been using Gawain as a decoy. Nero takes this chance to infiltrate the Zero Dark, Returning to her throne room, Altera fights amicably against Nero, and slays her with the teardrop photon ray. Upon completing both Hakuno and the regalia, Archimedes reveals himself once more, stealing Hakuno away. Altera opposes him, refusing to use the regalia to harm humanity. She is too late, however, as Archimedes had already broken the connection between hero Altera and her Titan body. Archimedes then forces the Titan to transform once more into Sephar. This erases all of the Titan's memories, which transfer to her hero avatar. Thus, they are unable to negotiate and are forced to incapacitate Sephar, which would in turn eliminate Altera. Sharing one final battle together, Hakuno and Altera vanquish Sephar. As Altera disappears, she thanks Hakuno for the beautiful days they spent together, expressing her joy for being treated as her own person. Thus, Altera vanishes, and Archimedes deems the timeline another bust. Hakuno is left alone with the completed regalia, and desperately tries to form a plan to save Altera from her tragic fate. They consider traveling back in time like Archimedes, but lack the time and functionality to do so, since there was insufficient time for Hakuno's cyberframe to fully reform itself. In a final effort, Hakuno decides to send only their memories back in time, before also vanishing. These memories flow backwards in time, losing their clarity along the way, before finally reaching their cyberframe's mind, the part that found its way to Nero. The memories are vague, but just complete enough for Hakuno's mind to find Archimedes suspicious early on. This Hakuno requests Nero's trust and fights through Seraph, not to defeat Tamamo and Altera, but rather to bring them together in a united front. With knowledge of Altera's dream to escape being a destroyer, Nero is able to earn their cooperation, successfully uniting the regalia and fully restoring Hakuno's cyberframe. This causes hero Altera and Hakuno's body to fade, but they entrust Nero with the Moon Cell's future. Before parting, Altera grants Nero the Sword of Mars to use in destroying the Ark. Without the chance to do so, however, Archimedes sends the Ark plummeting to the Moon Cell core in an effort to destroy it. According to his calculations, no one can stop him. However, Elizabeth Bathory defies all logic, accidentally freeing the Titan Altera's body from confinement. Altera arrives just in time to strike the Velber Shard and halt its descent. The impact and damage to the Ark caused the Titan Altera to disappear as well, leaving Nero and Hakuno alone to thwart Archimedes' last attempt to destroy the Moon Cell. Nero channels the Sword of Mars to gain the power of a god, taking on the powers of Venus to completely obliterate the Ark once and for all. Nero uses the last of Venus's divinity to allow Altera's spirit core to be reborn as a sleeping child. As the child awakens, Nero explains that Altera is no longer a destroyer and is instead welcome to a new, peaceful life in Seraph. In both celebration and romantic competition, Nero and Tamamo prepare a large feast of their respective culture's cuisine. Adorably, Altera interrupts them, confused by their rivalry. She asks whether their cooking is good or bad civilization, since it all appears appetizing. Nero confidently proclaims that, so long as they're all built upon human care, there are no bad civilizations. Hakuno, Nero, Tamamo, and Altera partake in the lavish feast. Peace endures in Seraph until Charlemagne is summoned by accident with two spirit grafts, one of the real king, Charles the Great, and another for his legendary counterpart. Altera hears Charles's voice and rushes to him. Long ago, when he had touched Sephar's remains, his determination and will flooded into Altera's dream. Through this, Altera understands Charles's pain and admires him for choosing to avert destruction. Despite not being blood-related, Altera thinks of him as family. Thus, when Charles the Great attempts to assimilate all of Seraph under his rule, Altera stands by him, fully aware that his actions are wrong. Ultimately, however, she joins with Hakuno to free Charles of his pain. While she is too damaged to fight him herself, she is present as Hakuno and Charlemagne's legend take him down. The two Charlemagnes vanish, but Altera believes the two could once again be considered by Seraph as two separate beings if they foster them first as attack programs. She reasons that the Moon Cell can use all the servants it can get for the day when Velber returns. Altera is a woman who, after being freed from her fate, uses that freedom to protect and watch over the people she's grown to care about. She leaves her mark on the world through love, only using her combat as a means to keep others safe. She is, more than any other, good civilization. Thanks for watching! If you enjoy this channel, help me beat the algorithm by liking, commenting, and sharing the video, subscribing to Otaku Daikun, and most of all, smashing that notification bell as if it were your waifu. That way, you'll never miss out on all of my anime content, lore videos, live streams, and Holy Waifu Wars polls. My vids are struggling to get featured, so that bell is absolutely critical. If you want to support me directly, check out my Patreon, or consider donating via Super Chat. And as always, celebrate your fandom!